Well, here we are in the book of Acts, and if you've been with us, we've been studying through the book of Acts. We're here in Acts chapter 8 this morning, and we're finishing up chapter 8. I'm going to encourage you to turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 8. We're going to be looking at verses 9 through 24, and that's where we're going to be studying this morning. And what I want us to do is kind of bring you up to speed of where we're going to be studying and looking at. So Acts chapter 8, verse 9 is what I'm going to be reading from, and I'm honest to read that, so I encourage you to open your Bibles to that, and so that you can follow along with me and see where we are heading this morning. Here's what it says. But there was a man named Simon, who had previously practiced magic in the city and amazed the people of Samaria, saying that he himself was somebody great. They all paid attention to him, from the least to the greatest, saying, "This man is the power of God that is called great." And they paid attention to him because for a long time he had amazed them with his magic. But when they had believed Philip as he preached good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Even Simon himself believed, and after being baptized, he continued with Philip. And seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed. Now when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For he had not fallen on any of them, but they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Now, when Simon saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money, saying, "Give me this power also, so that anyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." But Peter said to him, "May your silver perish with you, because you thought you could obtain the gift of God with money. You have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness of yours, and pray to the Lord that, if possible, to the intent of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity." And Simon answered, "Pray for me to the Lord, that nothing of what you have said may come upon me." Would you pray with me? Father, as we are opening up this the story, I pray that you will teach us. Guide us through your word. Help us to apply your word rightly. And help us to be transformed by your Spirit. So take this time now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, again, if you've been with us through the study of Acts, you remember we started in Acts chapter 1, and we've been moving through the book. And remember, like, when we got started here, so Jesus has given the command. We have one of the great commissions of what he's going to be doing in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." You remember that? So this is commands that Jesus has been sending the church, and so the church is getting established. And we see early on in Acts, we see the Spirit of God fall upon the church, and the church is established and becomes alive. And man, it's great things going on and early on in Acts, and how God's moving and stirring and gathering his people. And so many of the Jews who are all in Jerusalem, people are turning to Christ. And we've been seeing that throughout the chapters we're going through. We see thousands of people turning to Jesus. And these are all Jews for the most part who are turning to Christ and believing in him as the Messiah and the Christ. And you remember, we've been going through this, and we've been seeing the history of the early church being established in Jerusalem. And then we start to see, as we're going along there, some moments of times when persecution starts to rise. And remember, the apostles are brought in before the Sanhedrin and the great the court of the day, the religious court of the day, and they're threatened. And so we start seeing increased persecution. And then over the last couple of weeks, we saw even greater persecution. We saw Stephen, who was the first Christian martyr, the first one to lay his life down because of what he believed, of believing in Jesus Christ. And then if you remember, as we're going along there, we came into Acts chapter 8, and we see the spread of the gospel outside of the borders of Jerusalem. And he's moving beyond, just like Jesus had said in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, it's going to be moving beyond Jerusalem to Judea and Samaria. And so we see Philip, who's the evangelist, who goes and he lets others know about Christ into, of all places, Samaria. So if you're following along there, and then even next week, God willing, we're going to be opening up again into Acts chapter 9, and we're going to see the conversion of Saul, who becomes Paul, and great, amazing things that are going on in the church. I tell you all that history, okay? So hopefully you've been tracking with me so far, to ask the question, why this part? So as I'm reading through in Acts chapter 8, and we're seeing the history of the narrative of the story of the church being established, and then the Holy Spirit working, moving beyond just the borders of Jerusalem into Judea and Samaria and then to the ends of the earth, as we'll see later on, and moving on. As I'm studying through, I'm asking the question this week, and I'm saying, why did Luke include this into the text? Why did Luke, what we just read here of Acts chapter 8, verses 9 through 24, why did Luke include this story about Simon the magician? Well, what was the point? What was the purpose? As I'm wrestling through and trying to figure out, I mean, it's breaking the story. There's this extra added piece of the narrative of what's been happening in the church and the spread. And so why this? Why this part? And so here's a little survey, a little test that you can take. Here's a couple of things that I came up with as I'm studying through, and I'm wondering, here's why. Why did Luke take time out of the narrative to tell us this story about Simon the magician? Was it A, it's about a really popular guy who turns to Jesus? Could be. Or was it B, Luke is asking, what amazes you? I mean, if you notice in the first paragraph that we saw, three times the word amazed is included in there. By the way, whenever you're studying through scriptures, a lot of times when you're reading through and you see words that are repeated, sometimes there's something in that, so you want to pay attention. So maybe Luke is wanting us to ask us, what amazes you? That could be. So it's either about a really popular guy who turns to Jesus, or Luke is wanting us to know what, find out what amazes us. Or is it C? Is it a contrast between what's counterfeit and what's real? Is Luke drawing out for us what's fake, what's a fake ministry versus what a real ministry is? Could be. Or lastly, another one that I was thinking through and considering as I was studying this, is the reason why Luke includes this text in here for us so that we would stop and check our own motives about why we follow the Lord? Why do we follow the Lord? Why is Philip following, or Simon, why is Simon following after the Lord? Well, let's unpack it and see. Let's see what we come up with. In verses 9 through 11, we're introduced to Simon, right? I mean, he's a popular guy. I mean, this is the guy that has his own star on the road, on the sidewalk, with his name on it. He's incredibly popular. Look at verse 9 through 11. But there was a man named Simon who had previously practiced magic in the city and amazed the people of Samaria, saying that he himself was somebody great. And they all paid attention to him, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the power of God that is called great. And they paid attention to him because for a long time he had amazed them with his magic. I thought, man, it'd be cool if I had one of those little things and go, poof, when the little cloud went up and I disappeared or something, you know, it's cool magic. He's doing all kinds of illusions, all kinds of tricks. This guy is the real deal. And he was, I mean, imagine you come into the boulevard of Samaria and up on the giant building there is this big banner that says, Simon the Magician, Simon the Great, this week only. I mean, he's the known guy. Everybody wants to see him. He's incredibly popular. If you're reading the paper of the day, probably in the Samaritan Review Journal, it said something along the lines of, Simon the Great performed again last night. It was amazing. Mind-blowing works. This is a must-see for everybody. Everybody knew about this guy. You go in Samaria, they know about Simon the Magician. So much so that he was so great that they were even attesting deity to him. Now this guy is a god. To put it in our terms, his act had gone viral. Everybody knows about it. He's popular. He had money. My guess is that that kind of attention, he had preferential treatment wherever he went. As I'm studying this guy and considering his character, I think it's an incredibly difficult place to be. I think he's in a really hard place. I mean, he amazes people. They're amazed, which means astonishing, mind-blowing is what that means. Technically, it also means to stand up. Like, it's something you're going to stand attention to. You're like, oh, I've got to stand up and see this. What? It's kind of attention that this man, Simon, brings. People are coming to him for all kinds of things, from anything from a cure to a curse. Oh, we got to see Simon. We got to take care of, you know, you got a little problem here. We'll take care of that. He's got a cure. Or you got a problem with this person. Can we curse them? Absolutely, Simon will take care of that for you. Magicians, one of the scholars wrote, a historian said, magicians had a direct link to the divine world. And magic was seen as a gift from the gods. So they were peddlers of falsehood, and they had all kinds of illusions and all kinds of different tricks, and they gained all kinds of fear and respect and admiration, and they were well known, deceptive. They would deal with the spiritual realm. Simon doesn't give any credit to God for any of these things. He takes it for himself. A lot different than what we're going to see later with Paul and Barnabas. When they're attributed to any kind of deity, they completely reject it. Not this guy. Simon, he takes it. What a difference. Oh, he has the great power of God. We would say this is a false ministry. A counterfeit. It's a counterfeit, looks real, but it's not real. It's not the real thing. He has a fake ministry, a counterfeit ministry going on that's drawing in a whole lot of people. It just fit with the time. There's a lot of false ministries and counterfeit ministries. How do we identify? How would you know whether this guy is real or not? I mean, it looks amazing. How would you know? How would you recognize this is counterfeit versus this is real? When you look at ministries today, how do you identify whether this is a true ministry or a false ministry? As you look and study the church here at Summit, how do you recognize whether we're real or fake? Dare I ask? We should be looking at that. We should be looking to study that and look in scriptures. Now, let me just throw out real quickly three things that I would say as a quick overview of how to recognize a true ministry versus a false one? How do we recognize a counterfeit? Number one, a ministry that doesn't make Jesus central to its message is a false one. In other words, a person is exalted over Jesus, or even the ministry itself is exalted over Jesus. Is the focus on getting more stuff or getting more of Jesus? That'd be number one. Great way to identify. A ministry that doesn't make Jesus central to its message is a counterfeit. Number two, a ministry should set people free. Meaning, it's not binding them to more legalism. Well, you got to do this, this, and this, this, and then you're good. Oh, and this, and this, and this. Legalism, it just binds you and holds you up. It's not making false promises that the Bible never intended. Well, if you do this, then you'll be able to have such and such. One of those little indicators of that sometimes is a ministry will promise for a fix in temporary problems, to solve temporary problems if you do such and such. Not claims that the Bible makes. We talk about regularly here. If you're going to be a Christ follower, you're going to suffer. We talk about just enduring and going through trials. The Bible's rich in all kinds of examples of having to go through trials and tribulations, and that's part of life. It's to draw us to Christ, because Christ ultimately is our satisfaction. And if we're going to follow him, it's worth it. It's hard, but it's worth it. The third thing that I thought of in terms of recognizing a counterfeit ministry versus a real one, a ministry that is known for their own magic shows. What do I mean by that? You can turn on a lot of televangelists and see this kind of magic shows going on. That would fall into this kind of a bracket. Simon the Magician counterfeit ministry. So back to Simon, in fact. Simon the Magician, he has all kinds of attention. He's drawing a lot of people, and everybody wants to see him. He's popular. He has a ton of subscribers on his YouTube channel. I mean, this guy has it. And in verse 12, we see this shift that happens in verse 12. But when they believed Philip as he preached good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Losing prestige and popularity is an incredibly tough fate to endure. I think we're going to see that. People are believing the gospel. So Philip comes in, tells them about Jesus. They believe in Jesus. They trust in him. And they're turning to Christ. What we see even in verse 13 is even Simon believes, right? Simon himself believed, and after being baptized, he continued, or he remained with Philip. And seeing signs and great miracles or great wonders that are going on performed, even he is amazed. His mind's blown. Wow! I need that. The people are believing Philip's testimony, and so how does Simon respond? Well, he also believes. He also turns and he's following along. But based on what I see here in this text, I've been studying this throughout the week as I'm looking at this, I believe it's going to become really clear that Simon really doesn't have saving faith. I think what's happening is he's afraid of losing his following, that he's following after the wrong thing. But let's see. Let's see what transpires with Simon. We'll get a look into his heart in verses 14 through 17. Now when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For he had not yet fallen on any of them, but had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Two more verses. Now when Simon saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money, saying, "Hey, give me this power also, so that anyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." So the apostles come. There's evidence of salvation that's going on here. Remember what's happening in the church, right? The church has just been established. It's been in Jerusalem. Pentecost has happened. Many scholars will call this kind of the second Pentecost, or Pentecost, the Samaritans, because the Spirit of God is falling on them. But this is the first time the apostles have seen this outside of Jerusalem. Samaritans are now turning to Christ. Samaritans who have this quasi-weird religion versus the Jews. So how are they going to be included into the church and things? Well, it was important for the apostles, for Peter and John, to come and see that these two are also receiving the Spirit of God in the same way that they had. Wait a minute, so now we don't have two different churches that are being established. We have one church. They're all in one church. They're now full-fledged brothers and sisters in the kingdom, these Samaritans. We talked about last week the rift between the two of Samaritans and the Jews. But Samaritans that are turning to Christ, man, we're all part of the same family now. Wow. Didn't expect that, and we're going to see it a whole lot more in Acts chapter 15, actually, in the church, of accepting those who maybe aren't Jews. I mean, was that going to be okay? Oh, wait, they've received the Spirit of God, so must be part of the same family. The Spirit is given at the hands of the apostles, and to show convincingly that the Samaritans, that it's going to be important over time, that they too are the part of the family of God. Same full membership in God's family. No partiality in that. And I think what's happening here in these verses, I think what's happening here is that Simon is watching all that's taking place. And he's not getting his following. People have somewhat lost interest in him. So now he's wondering and asking, how do I get that back? And I think that comes through the questions in verses 18 and 19 of when he saw the Spirit had been given and laying on the apostles' hands, he offered them money, saying, "Hey, give me this power too." We really don't know his motivation at this point. I mean, supposing we hadn't read through the rest of this little bit, we really don't know his motivation. We're like, maybe he's genuine and he just really wants others to experience the good news of Jesus. And he thinks he has to pay for that or something. Maybe his motivation's there. Or maybe it's a loss of popularity and wanting to have that same kind of draw again. What I do know out of here is that you can't buy God. You can't buy spirituality. And what we have is we have Peter's response, which would seem incredibly harsh. It's sharp and to the point. He doesn't beat around the bush. Look at Peter's response in verses 20 through 23. But Peter said to him, "May your silver perish with you, because you thought you could obtain the gift of God with money. You have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. Repent, therefore, of the wickedness of yours, and pray to the Lord that, if possible, the intent of your heart may be forgiven you. for I see that you are in the gall of bitterness and the bond of iniquity. Whew, Peter. Sharp rebuke. There's boldness of the truth that Peter speaks. I see Peter like an oncologist who doesn't beat around the bush and says, you have cancer. It's got to be dealt with. Simon's heart is not right before God. He says in verse 23, he's in the gall of bitterness and the bond of iniquity. It's a clear picture, the gall of bitterness. It's a clear picture of what's intended here is this idea of somebody who's in deep envy or resentment for someone else. The gall of bitterness. Envy over what he's seeing with Peter and John and Philip and the bond of iniquity. In other words, he's handcuffed to wrongdoing. He's chained to it. And Peter, like a skilled surgeon, exposes Simon's motivation. We get to see into his heart through this. Simon's like, hey, let me be able to do the same kind of tricks as you guys are doing. How much is that going to cost me to learn that? And Simon's motivation isn't for following the Lord. Simon's motivation is very clear. It's about himself. And the cure that's offered by Peter is also equally clear. Repent and pray. Repent of your wickedness and pray. What came to mind was Isaiah 55:1. Listen to this. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And he who has no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. You see, the salvation to be able to follow the Lord is no charge. It's free. Come. Simon wants to buy it. So does Simon repent? Does he pray and repent? Is that what we see in verse 24? I mean, if anyone repents, you'll be in no way cast aside. So the question is, did you actually want to repent? Look at verse 24, and Simon answered, pray for me to the Lord that nothing of what you have said may come upon me. If you read this earlier or even now as you're thinking on that, it seems a little bit cryptic. So I'm thinking through, I'm like, hey, where's he at? Does it seem a little bit cryptic to you? Were you wondering, like, oh, I wonder, did he repent or not? I find it interesting that he doesn't refute anything that Peter said to him. He's not like, whoa, hold on, Pete. You totally got me wrong. None of that. Seems to accept it. Pray for me to the Lord that nothing of what you have said may come upon me. That nothing of what you've said may come upon me. Here's what I believe is going on. Check it yourself. Here's what I think's happening. I think that Simon is asking for an escape of the consequences without turning to Jesus. Listen very carefully to me. I believe this is a biblical example of many who play around the fringe of religion of Christianity without diving into the heart of it. They will do enough to try to avoid the consequences of sinful choices without really a desire and an intent to know Christ and the power of the resurrection. I don't see him turning to the Lord. I've heard this kind of response so many times in my ministry over the years. A person's caught in sin. Life as they know it is unraveling. They're experiencing the consequences to their bad choices. And how many times I've said, man, how can I help? And they're like, just pray for me. Without any acceptance of responsibility or action. I say this over and over again. Just pray. No responsibility, no repentance that requires change, action. Just, I want to avoid the consequences. Oh, this is such bad. I don't want the consequences. It hurts. It hurts a whole lot of other people. I don't like that. So just pray that it goes away and we'll be okay. I said over and over again that people want prayer but not change. And like this story, it's a travesty. I think it's tragic, this story. What's so bad about it? Oh, what's so tragic about this story, John? What's so tragic about staying in the condition of sin and just hoping that the consequences won't come? What's wrong with that? Because I think Simon had it all. I mean, he had the same thing that the American dream promises. He had it, and it's fleeting. You can't buy happiness. You can't buy God. And what's important is the pursuit of God and not all his stuff. Jesus said in John 17, "And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." That's eternal life. Philippians 3:10, "That I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death." Paul's proclamation. My proclamation. I think what's happened, why Luke stops in the regular narrative of the story of the church that's expanding to focus on Simon the magician here, because I think this is actually another call in the Bible for cross-carrying Christians to follow after the Lord, not all the stuff. We can suffer a whole lot of loss of things, but what is most tragic is if we were to lose knowing Christ. Listen to Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. "Though the fig tree should not blossom, nor the fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herds in the stall, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord." In spite of losing all the stuff, I'm going to rejoice in the Lord. I'll take joy in the God of my salvation. That is one of those verses you want to hang on to. You suffering today? Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. Go to your index in your Bible, and you'll have to scroll down and find out where that is. And then open up there and mark that. Jesus said this in Luke chapter 9, verses 23 through 26. "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words, of him will the Son of Man be ashamed when he comes in his glory and the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. You see, what Philip had, what the apostles had, what believing Samaritans had, what you and I have, for all true believers, you know what we have? We have God. We get Jesus. We get him. We get a million different mercies that come by knowing Christ. Gifts of God. We get those that he pours out upon all believers. Justification. Declared righteous. Relationship. We get so many different gifts and ongoing gifts that he pours out on his children. But apart from God, if you took God out of all of that, they mean nothing. We get God. We get Christ. There's no good news without God. Do you get that? There's no good news without Christ. Listen to Psalm 63. Oh God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory, because your steadfast love is better than life. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. That's the kind of heights of which the Bible calls us to knowing Jesus. That's what this is lifting us up and pointing us toward, is that we get to know Christ. That's the supreme. That's the best. There's nothing greater than that. My soul longs for you, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God. Psalm 84, 2. Get to know him. So I think what's so tragic with this story here of Simon is that he completely misses the point. He misses out on eternal life. All the examples that Luke gives is from Simon as he's watching. He's not a participant in receiving the Spirit of God. He's watching. He's like, oh man, how much is that going to cost? That's great. He's not experiencing it. He's standing back and watching. And he misses out on getting God. That's the ultimate satisfaction and joy. That's what we need. A church, that's what we need. Don't be a Simon. Don't just go around the fringes of Christianity in the church, but know Christ. Don't just play the part. Don't be a Simon. But know Jesus. Get him. Don't miss out on your satisfaction. Get to know him. I think that's why Luke includes this. For us to ask the question of, why do I follow after the Lord? Is it for the stuff? Or is it so that I get God? Let's pray. God, this is a challenging text. This is loaded with so many areas for us to evaluate and test our own heart. So God, for a moment, would you search our hearts? Would you search our hearts so that, God, we would be right with you, getting you? Well, thank you for all the gifts, but without you, God, they just lack. They don't satisfy without you. God, you are the gospel. You are the good news. And I pray that we'd be a church that would cling to God, cling to you, cling to Jesus. That even if it all falls apart, God, we have you. We turn to you, God. We lift up our voices. We check our hearts. We worship because of who you are and that you are the good news. In Christ alone is our satisfaction. Amen.